31 through 33 due to technical difficulties. I'm going to be the last verse in there, but we'll also read verse 41. So don't forget that. It's kind of key to our scripture today. But as you're turning there, Matthew is the first gospel. So we reach the New Testament. Congratulations, you found Matthew. Turn to the 25th chapter, and that's where we'll be at. But while you're turning there, we are looking today at our second part of our study in eschatology. We're looking at the study of end times. Last week, we looked at the personal eschatology, or what will happen to each individual at the end times. And we looked at two different roads with two distinct destinations. And we looked at the idea of heaven and hell. So personal eschatology, escha meaning end, and ology meaning study of. Today we're going to look at eschatology in the sense of end times and the end of all things. And really, that's kind of what that last song was about, right? There's an old Southern Baptist, I don't even know if Southern Baptist, probably other churches. You know, I looked in the back of the book and you win, right? You know, our God is truly unstoppable. I want to get those lyrics right. I took a little picture there. It says, nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. And he is truly an unstoppable God. So we look then and we see that this end times is really just God doing what God does. And he is unstoppable. And he is a God that is going to bring things forward which he has said he will do. So let's look into our verse today, Matthew 25, 31 through 34 and 41. It says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then he will say to those on his left, he will say to those, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. If you would, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for this time that we can study your word, and thank you for the time that we come and we can preach. And I pray that as I preach today that you hide me behind the cross. Not let these be my words, but your words. May they go out and may they take us further into faith, further into this journey of life. And may we go out into this world and go and be the church to the nations. We love you and we ask all these things in your precious name. Amen. Now often when we study end times, we tend to get bogged down in a lot of the details. We tend to get bogged down in what will happen and exact things that will happen. But today we're going to look at three things I think that we can pull out from these scriptures. But don't get so concerned with the details. There's essentially two things that we get caught up on. In Revelation 20, it describes the millennial reign of Christ. And there are three distinct views on that. And look, there are great and godly people that hold each and every view. And there are some good points and some bad points to each view. There are some pros and some cons. But they essentially boil down to how we view and we look at the millennial reign of Christ. There's pre-millennials, which obviously is Christ reigning before the millennial. There's post-millennialism, which is God reigning after the millennial. And then there's amillennialism, which basically says the millennial is kind of a metaphor and it's apocalyptic talk and it's not really a thousand-year literal reign. For me, I hope post-millennialism is right because that is gospel-centered. Essentially, the teaching is that the gospel wins. We spread the gospel and the kingdom is further and is further and is further. And it comes to a point where all those who are saved are saved, and then Jesus comes back. Now that teaching was kind of squashed in the 40s with the reign of Hitler or World War II. It's kind of the optimistic. It's hard to be optimistic when you have World War going on. So each phase, each teaching, like I said, has its pros and its cons, and that's how we kind of look at it. Times a lot of times we get bogged down
in the details. And then you look at the rapture or the tribulation, and there's once again three views on how you view the church in the rapture. You have a pre-tribulation, the church is taken out before the tribulation. You have a mid-tribulation, the church is taken out halfway through the tribulation. And then you have a post or a tribulation where the church goes through the whole thing. And so we can get all arguing and we can get talking about it. And I think we get concerned and we get focused away from what the real end times is teaching us. I was in school and a long time ago and actually had watches, right? And people wore watches. And we were sitting around and talking. And it was like 2 hours we were talking about end times. And we're just having a discussion. And a lot of times when you get into these end time talks, they get kind of heated because you're passionate about Jesus returning. And I looked at my watch and I was like, guys, we've been here for like 2 hours talking about this. And I said, can you imagine what we would have done if we would have been out witnessing and talking to people about Jesus for these last 2 hours? So don't get bogged down in the details of the end times. But look at these three things and realize that Jesus returns, that there's going to be a final judgment, and then finally there is going to be the consummation of everything. And so we agree and we look at Scripture and we read Scripture, and I think these are the three main things that we can take out of eschatology in times. Jesus returns is a key one. Millard Erickson describes the return of Jesus when he says, with the exception of the certainty of death, the one eschatological doctrine on which Orthodox theologians most agree is the second coming of Christ. It is the basis of the Christian's hope, the one event that will mark the beginning of the completion of God's plan. See, the second coming is agreed on by most pastors, by most theologians, and most lay people because we read it in Scripture and it is plainly laid out there. It is plainly seen in Scripture. In Jesus' great teaching in end times in Matthew 24 and 25, he speaks of the second coming as a definitive thing. As definitive in nature, as something that is definitely going to happen. Listen to what he says in Matthew 24, 30. At that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the nations of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. Not maybe one day the sign of the Son of Man will come, and not maybe He'll come. I'll come back in great glory and great power. But these are definitive things that Jesus says these will definitely happen. Jesus mentions his return several other times in those two chapters. In verse 27, in verse 37, in verse 39, in verse 42, and verse 44. See, each of the Gospels record Jesus speaking matter-of-factly about the second coming of Christ, about his return. And it is mentioned in Acts, it's mentioned in Philippians, in 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, Titus, 1 and 2 Timothy, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 1 and 2 Peter, and 1 or John. So it's mentioned all throughout the Bible, and as we read the Bible, we see that we place this hope in the second coming of Christ. So we're all about to transition, some of us a little sooner, as we saw some kids down here, and some stores, we're transitioning to Christmas time, right? And we have this Christmas time of year, and it's a great time of year, don't get me wrong, one of my favorite holidays, where we celebrate the birth of Jesus. So the birth and the coming of Jesus the first time is a great and glorious thing. And both comings of Christ, the first coming and the second coming, have things in common, but where they differ, they differ greatly, and it is awesome, it is glorious to see the second coming of Christ. So let's look at the second coming of Christ. See, the first coming was in a physical form, Jesus coming to earth in the form of a babe and a manger, and so too will the second coming. See, it's going to be a physical coming. It's going to be a physical Jesus appearing in physical bodily form. Acts 1:11 says, "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you've seen him go into heaven." See, this is at the ascension of Christ. The disciples are sitting there, and they're watching Jesus being taken up to heaven, and they're kind of dumbfounded. They're kind of in shock and awe. They're looking up into heaven, and they're just standing there, and they don't really know what quite to do. Because Jesus has been with them this whole time, and he's back, and he's resurrected, and he ate with them, and preached with them, and he lived with them. And so here he is, he's physically taken up into heaven, and they're there watching. And the angels, and they say to them, the men with them, and they say, look, in the same manner, in the same Jesus, he's going to come back in the same way. So it's going to be a physical return. Just like the first time he was physically born and brought into this earth. But the second time, he's going to come back in that same physical manner, in that same physical way. So it's physical in nature, but it's also perceptible. It's also something that we can see and that we will know about. See, unlike the first coming of Jesus, unlike the first time he arrived in a manger, with only a few witnesses, some shepherds, some sheep, some angels, his mom and his dad, to witness the event. Oh, see, this is where it differs, though. Remember, we talked about there's similarities. But here's one of the major differences. See, the second coming will be seen by all. Acts 1:11 again. And he's going to come in the same manner. He's going to come in the same way, descending on the cloud for all to see. And Matthew 24:30 says, every nation will see this event. And Matthew 25:31 tells of the worldwide nature of his second coming. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call. And they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. See, with all of this coverage, with Fox News, CNN, MSNBC, whatever coverage you see, and we see things on a global nature now, right? And you can be rest assured that this will be one event that is going to be covered by those stations. And so when Jesus returns, it's going to be physical in nature, and it's going to be perceptible that we can all see it. And the angels are going to come, and they're going to collect the fellow believers in Christ from one end, from north, south, east, and west. And they're all going to gather, and we're all going to see it, and we're all going to know about it. It's something that's going to be great and glorious, but it's also something, while it's physical, while it's perceptible, it's also going to be unexpected. See, we are told to be prepared for the second coming. And we're told to be anxious about it and to be hopeful for it. But we are told that no one except God knows when it will happen. So listen, if someone warns you and tells you, hey, you're not going to make it through Thanksgiving because of the second coming of Christ, I'd still probably thaw out my turkey. And I'd still probably be prepared for Thanksgiving because no one knows except for God. See, Matthew 24:36-42 records Jesus' words about this. He says, but about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the second coming of man, at the coming of the Son of Man. The time that two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two men will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know at what day your Lord will come. See, we're supposed to hope for it, we're supposed to be excited about it, we're supposed to look forward to it, but it's an event that we don't know exactly when happen. Kind of like being pregnant, when your wife is pregnant or you're pregnant. You kind of know when the baby's going to be due, right? And you may have a kind of glimpse, you may have a due date in mind, but until you start feeling those pains, until the water breaks, and until your husband's flying 90 miles an hour to the hospital, right? You don't know the exact day. You're excited about it, and you're waiting for it, but you don't know exactly when it'll happen. And that's what Jesus says. He says, look forward to it, please. It's going to be awesome. And it's going to be great. But be careful because you don't know when it'll happen. He describes the days of Noah. And Noah is in the middle of the desert. And he's building this ark. And the people are making fun of him, and they're saying, it's never rain. We're in the desert. Why are you building a boat? And they were happy, and they were living their lives, and they were eating and drinking and being married and going on and living their lives normal until the day that Noah went into the ark, and God shut the ark. And it started to rain. And then at that point, they thought, well, maybe Noah wasn't as crazy as we thought he was. Because that's how it's going to be like. We're going to be in a field and we're going to be working. And one will be taken and one will be left. And it'll be a time of great upheaval, but it'll be a time of great excitement. See, it's going to be physical in nature. It's going to be perceptible. But it's going to be also unexpected. We're not going to know when it's going to happen, but it's going to happen. So we can't wait. We can't put it off. We can't say, well, I'll know. I'll get to know Jesus at that time, right before it happens. Don't know when it'll happen. And it'll also be exalting. It's going to be a great and glorious time. While we might not know about the events, while we might not know about the surprise party we're going to have, it doesn't change the fact that the party is going to be awesome and it's going to be great. It's going to be a time of lifting God up. It's going to be a time of exalting His name. And unlike the first coming of Christ, where He was a humble babe in a manger, and it was lowly, it was with the animals. The second coming of Christ is going to be, oh, so much different, right? It's going to be a time of lifting Jesus up in praise. It's going to be a time of praising His name and being glorified and Him being awe-inspiring and angels and archangels singing His glory. Matthew 24:30 and Mark 13:26, Luke 21:27 say, He will come on the cloud with great glory and power. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 describes it as being heralded by the angels and the archangel. And Matthew 25:31-46 says that He will sit on His glorious throne and judge all the nations. It's going to be a great and it's going to be a wonderful time. So you have all these things that the second coming is going to be. And if you would, just imagine yourself for a moment. You're in a courtroom, right? And the judge has ordered a verdict of $1 million. So if you are the one that is going to be rewarded the verdict, and let's say you're the one going to be receiving the $1 million, it's a great, glorious day, right? You just got $1 million. It's time to party. It's time to have a good time. Time to buy your mom a house or whatever you're going to get. Right, because this is celebration time. Well, maybe you're in the courtroom, and that judge has issued the verdict, and you're being restored $1 million. You're being given back $1 million. Now you're happy, and you're glad that you get $1 million back, but you may not be as excited as the guy that just got $1 million. And maybe you're in the courtroom, and the judge has issued the verdict of $1 million, and you're the one that has to pay that $1 million. I don't know about you, but, I mean, good luck getting that. I don't have $1 million. And you can work all day long. But can you see the same verdict, the same judge sitting in the same chair with the same robe and His power and His might issuing the verdict, but three different and distinct ways of receiving that word verdict? See, the second coming is happening. Jesus is going to return, but there will be a final judgment on that day. And see, this final judgment for some will be a reward. For some, it'll be that $1 million reward. For those who are in Christ, this is a great and glorious day. It's a reward. It's a time where we'll be folded back into the faith of Christ, where we'll be with God, and we'll be like God. And 1 Peter 5:4 describes it as, he says, when the head shepherd comes, your reward will be never ending. Share in His glory and honor. See, we're brought back into this beautiful, this awesome time where we partake in God's glory and Christ's glory, and we share in Him, and He is revealed to us. See, unlike last time, where He came as a babe in a manger, and He lived a sinless life, and He took our sins on the cross, our beatings, and our bruises. This time, He's coming back completely different. Not to bear our sins, but to reward us for our faithful and our glorious lives, our by grace through faith we've been saved, and that brings us into that standing in Christ. The author of Hebrews put puts it this way in Hebrews 9, 28. So Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are awaiting him. See, this, remember, this isn't a magic lottery ticket. This is being folded back into Christ. This is being folded back into this wonderful relationship of Christ. It is being fully known by God and fully knowing God. This is our reward for being a good and faithful servant. See, for that day, for the second coming, oh, it's going to be great. And it's going to be glorious. And it's going to be a reward. And we're going to be happy. But for some of them, it's a restoration. See, there will be a restoration in those days of the Jewish people. Now, I believe it's going to be a great revival breaking out in the midst of all of the things happening at the end times. But look, I'm not too proud to say, and I'm not too boastful to say, look, I don't exactly know how it's going to work out. For even Paul calls it a mystery. In Romans 11, he talks about this idea of the Jews being restored back into faith. And he describes it this way. He says, I asked them, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham, from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what Scripture says in passages about Elijah, how he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I am the only one left, and they are trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed to the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant, a chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. And if it were grace, it would no longer be grace. What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. The elect among them, but the others were hardened. As it is written, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see, and ears that could not hear, to this very day. When David says, may their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see, and their backs be bent forever. Again, I ask, did they stumble as to fall beyond recovery? No, not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if their transgressions means riches for the world, and their losses means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their full inclusion bring? I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that union may not be conceded. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of Gentiles has come in, and in this way, all Israel will be saved as it is written. The deliverer will come from Zion, and he will turn godlessness away from Jacob. So it's a mystery. We don't know how they're going to be folded in. I can imagine it's going to be a great and glorious revival when they realize, oh, he was our Savior. He was our Messiah, and we missed it. And so Paul sees it as a mystery. So we accept it on faith that for somehow, for some way, they're going to be folded back into this faith by grace. And so it's this glorious day for them because they'll be restored to this. See, we should praise God for that. And we should be glorifying God for that because it shows us that he's still in the restoration business. He's still in the business of restoring people back to where they should be. So it should give us hope for those that have not come to faith. It should give us to those that don't have that grace, don't have that faith. It should give us hope that we too can be restored. He's not turned our back on them, and he surely won't turn his back on us. But see, for some it's going to be a reward. For some it's going to be a restoration. But for some of us, it's going to be a reckoning. It's going to be a time where we're going to have to pay for things that we've done. See, for some of us, the day of judgment will be exactly that. A day of judgment. See, they've lived their lives turning from God. They've lived their lives for themselves, or they've lived their lives simply just being good people. And at the end, they're going to exactly get what they want. A life separate and apart from God. See, this journey is taking them away from God, and that's exactly where it's going to leave them. The Apostle John records for us on the day of judgment in Revelation 20, 11, 12, and 15. He says, "Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. Then I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." It's going to be a sad day for some. And I hope and I pray that our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. So it's going to be a reward. It's going to be a restoration. But for some of us, it's going to be a sad, sad day of reckoning. See, the end times is the consummation of everything. See, Jesus is coming back, not like the first time, to start the process of salvation. But he's coming back to end everything, to consume everything, to have this everything completed. It's going to be the consummation of everything. It's the completion of the journey that we began in Genesis 3:15, where the great prophecy was said that he will bruise his heel, but the daughter or the son of the Adam and Eve will crush the head of the serpent. And all the prophecies in the Old Testament pointing to the Messiah and to the day that he will restore his people. And the New Testament pointing to Jesus and everything that he mentioned, the return of the Son of Man. See, he consumes all that. It completes all that. It's the consummation of all that. The completion of Jesus' mission of which he came to seek and to save the lost. The completion of the journey of faith where each of us are going to reach our road that we've chosen. We go through the narrow door or the wide door. We follow that path that leads us ultimately to our destination of myself and me and I and what I wanted, or to that great and glorious city on a hill. And then it's going to be the consummation, the completion of what Lord Jesus came to do. So he came to seek and to save the lost. Salvation will be folded back into the grab of the family. We will be that shining city on a hill. It's going to be the completion of life that has been devoted to self or denial of God. And finally, it's going to be the return of Jesus. It's going to be the consummation of all things. See, the earth groans and trembles, and the world looks for this place to be different and better, and it will be one day. And that's the second coming of Christ. He's going to come back. He's going to make it like it should have been in the beginning in the Garden of Eden. He's going to bring it back to where it was and where it should have been the whole time. But see, I hope and I pray that it is a day of reward for you. And I hope and I pray that we can see the restoration of his people. And I hope and I pray that it is not a day of reckoning, that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. If you would, pray for me. Heavenly Father, you are a great and awesome God. And we do pray that each and every one of us here has a relationship with you, that we are saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves, but of you and what you've done on the cross. And I hope and I pray that each of us on that day of judgment, when we sit before Christ, when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, that he'll look at us and he'll say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And he'll take us into that glorious reward of heaven, that shining city on the hill. And I pray that for those that don't know Christ, that those that don't have their name written in the Lamb's book of life, may they take today to set apart some time to know you, to talk to somebody about what it means to be saved, what it means to know Christ, because the Son of Man is coming back. It is a definitive thing. It is something that has been set. It is something that we as believers can look forward to, can rejoice in, that we see that this final judgment isn't something to be scared of, but something to be exalting Christ and to lifting Christ up. Heavenly Father, we love you and we ask all these things in your precious name. Amen. So if you have any questions about joining our church, or if you have any questions about what it means to be a Christian, I will be down here in front to talk with you after service. Please connect with some small groups throughout the week connect with one another and grow closer to each other through discipleship. And when we go out into this world and reach each other in missions, I ask that may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be on you, and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please find someone new, introduce yourself, give Cam a big old hug, and thank you for joining our church and fellowship before we start packing up. God bless.
You do.